Hello and welcome to the lesson looking at how were the German people affected by World War II. Now you should have already done the starter on Teams with your teacher. If you haven't, you need to go back and make sure that they know that you're doing the work and you're here, and obviously you need to return to lesson for at least the last 5 minutes. If you do have a printer, you can print some of the sheets on Show My Homework and it will save you a little bit of time. If you don't worry, you can still do all the work perfectly well without these sheets as well. Okay, so you've seen on that starter that you've done with your teacher that the Nazis had two economic aims when they first came to power in 1933. They wanted to try and make sure that they solved the problems of unemployment. They wanted to give the people work and bread, but they also in the long term wanted to try and prepare Germany for a future war. Now, what you're going to have to do once I've talked through it is to answer the two questions in purple here about why was the four-year plan needed and what was the four-year plan. So, first of all, the four-year plan, why was it needed? Well, Germany had lost the First World War because of the naval blockade. Remember, this is where the British ships had stopped any food getting into Germany as a way of starving them out. It was horrendous, but it did work. 400,000 German civilians had died as a result from starvation or diseases linked to malnutrition. And therefore, Hitler wanted to make sure that Germany was self-sufficient. He'd anticipated that there would be a war in the future because of his aggressive foreign policy, and he wanted to make sure that Germany didn't lose that future war. So they decided from 1936 to put in place something called the four-year plan that would get Germany ready for war within 4 years. Hitler thought that the Second World War, if it was going to break out, would probably start around 1940. And obviously he hadn't expected Britain and France to go to war over Poland in September 1939. So what was the four-year plan? As we've already mentioned, it was about getting Germany to be self-sufficient in terms of food, but also in materials. They didn't want to have to rely on imports from any other nation. They wanted to be totally self-sufficient. And Hitler put a man called Goering in charge of this plan, which began in 1936. And remember, it's all about getting the German economy ready for war. This is going on alongside when Hitler has been building up his army. Remember from conflict and tension that his army goes from 100,000 in 1933 to being 1.4 million by 1939. So they're trying to make sure that they don't rely on food imports, and when they do have to rely on food imports from other countries, they try to develop new substitutes. For instance, instead of growing their own coffee, which they couldn't in the climate of Germany, instead they try and make their own substitute coffee from things like acorns. They try and make their own petrol from coal, and they try and make their own makeup from things like flour. Essentially, this four-year plan is about coming up with a series of alternatives to make sure that they are only reliant on themselves. So that's what they were doing, and it did help their economy because it gave lots of people jobs working in the new industries, and so it helps them in a couple of ways. Makes them more self-sufficient and also means that more people have more jobs. So I'd like you to pause the video here and answer these two questions in purple. Make sure it's in your own words and using some of the information that we've got on this slide. So we now know what the four-year plan was, but now we're going to think about what were the successes and failures. I'll talk through this briefly, and then once I have, I'd like you to answer this question in your own words. Overall, would you argue the four-year plan was a success? To achieve what they wanted to. Remember, they want to make themselves self-sufficient in 4 years. Well, let's first of all think about the successes then. So first of all, they increased military production in order to give more people jobs and allow them to be able to fight a future war. They also had very high production targets that they set, and in some cases they did actually achieve them. So for instance, they set themselves ambitious targets for steel and explosive production, and they did meet those impressive targets in certain areas. Some businesses also benefited from these policies because there was increased investment in them. So even though we've seen there's been some successes in some of the industries like steel and explosives, let's think about the negatives or limitations of the four-year plan. Now, first of all, Goering had talked about how they were going to prioritise guns over butter. He wasn't actually talking about butter in that circumstance, but he was suggesting that they were going to prioritise the military over the consumers and the ordinary people. So they did focus more on rearmament than on producing consumer goods, and therefore the price of things like food and other consumer products went up. So they hadn't meant it to, but as a result, there was increasing costs of things like food. Also, we've seen that they achieved some of their production targets in certain areas, but certainly they didn't achieve it in all. So for instance, in things like oil production, they didn't achieve as much as they said they were going to. Furthermore, Germany was actually not ready for the long war it would become involved in from 1939. Their economic problems were quite severe, and they managed to mask it in the first couple of years of war when they just kept invading other places successfully and they were able to steal off all of their resources and their food and things. But in a long drawn out war like World War II was, it wasn't a good long term policy, and actually they weren't ready for the war in 1939. I think this next one here that I'm highlighting in blue is absolutely essential to include in your answer. Actually, they still imported a third of their raw materials by 1939. So they had wanted to be completely self-sufficient, but actually, they're still importing a third of the raw materials. That shows there's been some progress, but it's definitely not completely self-sufficient like they said they were intending it to be. So I'd like you to pause here and answer that question about overall, would you argue the four-year plan was a success? Try and use two of the successes and at least two of the limitations in your answer, but write it in your own words. So we've now looked at the preparations for war. What we're going to focus on for the rest of the lesson is what the impact of war was on Germany itself. Now, what we're going to find is that for the first couple of years of the war, Germany was actually doing really well, as we can see from this map here. Now, even before the war, takes place, we can see that Germany has already expanded. So you can see in the middle Czechoslovakia in yellow and Austria as well. Both of those have been taken over by 1938 or the beginning of 1939. Hitler then invaded Poland in September, and he then expanded the amount of land he had. And we can see by the end of 1940 that Hitler has successfully managed to invade all these different places like Norway, Denmark, Holland, Belgium, France, and places like Luxembourg as well. So Hitler has been incredibly successful by 1940. And even by the end of 1941, he's even more successful, having successfully invaded Lithuania, Latvia, Estonia, places like Yugoslavia as well. So the German war military machine was doing really well in these first couple of years of war. And this helped make it so the German civilians didn't really suffer as much because they were able to take lots of goods from those different locations. We're going to see that Hitler makes two very bad decisions in 1941, two decisions that lead to the German loss of the Second World War. The first one is that he tried to invade the Soviet Union in June 1941, and even though he was successful at first, the sheer size of Russia and the cold winters would end up defeating him in things like the Battle of Stalingrad. And also in 1941, in December, Hitler decides to declare war on America after the Japanese bombing of Pearl Harbor. Both of those crucial decisions that led to the loss of the Second World War. You don't need to write anything down from this. I just wanted to give you a little bit of a context of what it was like for Germany fighting this first couple of years. I just talked to you about those first 2 years of the war. What I'd like you to do now is to read through this slide, which has got some of the points that I was talking about before, and I'd like you to then describe in your own words how Germany was doing in those first 2 years. If you printed the sheets, there's a box for you to write in. If you haven't, just put it underneath your title. So I'd like to pause here, read through that information, and then just make some brief notes on the first 2 years of the war. You don't have to write this in any great detail, just pick out a few things. Okay, so now we're going to be thinking about the impact of the war on German civilians, and there are four different areas that we're going to be looking at. If you've got the sheet printed, you'll have a sheet that looks like this, where you're going to make some bullet pointed notes. If you haven't printed the sheet, all you're going to do is a spider diagram with those same four headings on it. So we're going to be looking at how the war affected them, and we're going to be thinking about rationing, we're going to be thinking about bombing, the refugee crisis, and also what went on in terms of people's jobs and the shortage of labour. So those are the four areas we're going to be looking at. And it's worth remembering this in exams using this RARE acronym. So the idea of rationing, area bombing, refugees and employment. Okay, let's make a start. The first area you're going to need to make notes on is rationing. You can make notes as I'm talking through it, or you can pause the video afterwards and then make some notes from that. Remember, you don't need loads and loads of detail, just a few key points are all you need. So first of all, from 1939, rationing didn't really impact on the German people. When they were winning and they were so successful, defeating six nations in only a matter of weeks, they didn't really have to go without. Occasionally they'd had shortages of things like soap, but they certainly hadn't had really limited food. However, from 1941, when they've invaded the Soviet Union and the tide is starting to turn against the German army, the German people soon start to realise how difficult war can be and how much they're going to have to do without. Supplies were really needed for the soldiers, you know, fighting in really tough conditions, some of them in the Russian winter when it could get to minus 40. So therefore, the German people at home had to make sacrifices. This resulted in some cases of severe food shortages. At some points, people could only get things like one egg per week. Now, the Nazis didn't give everybody the same rations like people in Britain got. Instead, they decided to give extra rations those people that they deemed necessary, people that they found vital for the war effort. So, for instance, if you worked in heavy industry, let's say you worked in a weapons factory, you might get some more because you're doing quite tough physical labour and they wanted to make sure that you could carry on doing that. They also gave extra food to pregnant women and blood donors. Now, this extra food came from taking it away from other people. So, for instance, Jewish people had their food entitlements set way below that of the Aryans. So this was a really terrible process for some people who had to survive on about 300 calories a day. The Nazis viewed that as necessary in order to help the war effort. So worth thinking that overall, rationing didn't normally affect the Germans that badly in comparison to some other nations. However, it is worth bearing in mind that in the last year of the war, ration cards were no longer honoured and shortages of food and clothing were really severe. So overall, the German people didn't suffer as much as some other nations when it came to food and rationing. However, certainly by 1945, the German economy was in tatters. There were loads of refugees and a lot of people couldn't access enough food. I'd like you to pause the video here and make some notes if you haven't already. Next, we're going to be moving on to the bombings. Now, I think it's important when we talk about bombings to think about the accounts of people that experienced this. Now, I'm sure you already know lots about the Blitz that happened particularly in 1940, and this was where cities like London were bombed. We also have to think about what were the British and Americans doing back to Germany, especially from 1942. And this is what one witness who was around during the bombing of Dresden said about their experience. There were no warning sirens. We were completely surprised and rushed back down to the cellars of the hospital. But these quickly became hopelessly overcrowded with people who could no longer find shelter in their own burning buildings. The crush was unbearable. We were so tight that you could not fall over. Apart from the fire risk, it was becoming increasingly impossible to breathe in the cellar because the air was being pulled out by the increasing strength of the blaze. So quite a horrifying account of what it must have been like to feel the fear of these firebombs that were destroying so many German cities. You don't need to write any of this down, but I think it's interesting to show you about some of the particular bombing raids and the results of them. So, for instance, you can see in February 1943, there was a bombing of Dresden where 150,000 people were killed. In 1943, in July, there was a bombing of Hamburg where there was another 45,000 deaths. We also have other bombings of Hamburg later on that year, another about 100,000 deaths. And then we also have other bombings in cities like Berlin as well. The whole point was to try and crush the German spirit and make them end the war, just like what the Germans had done to Britain back in 1940. We're now going to watch a quick documentary clip that's going to tell you more about the bombings and what they were like. If you want to, you could make some points whilst you're listening.
Every year on the 13th of February, the people of Dresden commemorate the destruction of their city by Allied bombers. Like Hiroshima, Dresden has come to epitomize the horrors of modern aerial warfare. But there were many other places that endured a similar fate.
There were other German cities that suffered just as much as Dresden did. And I cite Würzburg as an example. Dresden's been pointed out as the pinnacle of the area bombing of the war, but I mean, other targets such as Würzburg were comparatively, just as badly affected. I believe there were several thousand people killed in it.
For most of the war, Allied bombers had spared Würzburg because the town was of little military importance. But on the 16th of March 1945, more than 80% of Würzburg was destroyed. Almost 5,000 people were killed.
There was fire everywhere. People were screaming, throwing themselves into the river to put out the flames and falling from windows like burning torches. I wouldn't wish for anyone to go through what we did.
Time Watch has unearthed documents that help explain just why towns like Würzburg were ever bombed. This film casts new light on the final stages of the Allied bombing campaign in World War II. Before the war, the British government rejected the bombing of non-military targets as illegal. In 1938, Chamberlain had stated in Parliament that air attacks on civilians were against international law. But this policy was abandoned when the Blitz on British cities showed that the Germans had little respect for civilian lives.
We will mete out to the Germans the measure, and more than the measure, they have meted out to us. We will have no truce or parley with you or the grisly gang who works your wicked will. You do your worst, and we will do our best.
The Germans started it was a phrase on everybody's lips, from the Prime Minister downwards. I don't think it's terribly surprising.
Every year on the 13th of February, the people of Dresden commemorate the destruction of their city by Allied bombers. Like Hiroshima, Dresden has come to epitomize the horrors of modern aerial warfare. But there were many other places that endured a similar fate.
There were other German cities that suffered just as much as Dresden did. And I cite Würzburg as an example. Dresden's been pointed out as the pinnacle of the area bombing of the war, but I mean, other targets such as Würzburg were just as badly affected. I believe there were several thousand people killed in it.
For most of the war, Allied bombers had spared Würzburg because the town was of little military importance. But on the 16th of March 1945, more than 80% of Würzburg was destroyed. Almost 5,000 people were killed.
There was fire everywhere. People were screaming, throwing themselves into the river to put out the flames and falling from windows like burning torches. I wouldn't wish for anyone to go through what we did.
Time Watch has unearthed documents that help explain just why towns like Würzburg were ever bombed. This film casts new light on the final stages of the Allied bombing campaign in World War II. Before the war, the British government rejected the bombing of non-military targets as illegal. In 1938, Chamberlain had stated in Parliament that air attacks on civilians were against international law. But this policy was abandoned when the Blitz on British cities showed that the Germans had little respect for civilian lives.
We will mete out to the Germans the measure, and more than the measure, they have meted out to us. We will have no truce or parley with you or the grisly gang who work your wicked will. You do your worst, and we will do our best.
The Germans started it was a phrase on everybody's lips from...
So you've already been introduced to the bombings and you've seen that they ended up blanket bombing lots of different cities. So what I'd like you to do is to use the points that are on here to make a few notes about bombings. Remember, you're not expected to write in loads of detail, just a few key points will be absolutely fine. Okay, so first of all, we know that these bombings in Germany really started from 1942. Quite often Britain would bomb during the day and then America would bomb it during the night. So it was this relentless attack by both of them. Initially, as you heard in the video, they tried to target their bombing raids on industrial and military targets. They realised that that wasn't very effective because they weren't very accurate. And instead, they then switched to a policy of area bombing. This involved them targeting large industrial cities, as you've seen before, places like Dresden and Hamburg, and they would then use these different bombs that caused massive firestorms, really destructive and terrible for the civilians that lived there. In reality, 50% of their bombs fell on residential areas and only 12% actually hit factories. They bombed 61 German cities, and we know that Dresden and Hamburg suffered the most. So due to the impact of these bombs, it really did affect the German people. Quite often there was no electricity, water or transport, and people then started leaving their homes to try and look for refuge. We'll talk more about the refugee crisis in a second. Overall, as a result of the bombings in Germany, 3.6 million homes were destroyed, 7.5 million people were made homeless, and between 300,000 and 400,000 civilians were killed in these raids. So the Nazis were trying to keep everybody positive and they were trying to keep up support. But ultimately, support for the Nazis did weaken as a result of these bombings. But yet, people didn't call for the end of the war. They didn't call for the removal of Hitler. There was still support for the Nazis right to the very end. We know from looking at bombing, there were a lot of people that lost their homes and became refugees. We're just going to talk about some key points to do with this, and afterwards I'd like you to pause the video and add some more notes to your spider diagrams. So first of all, there were huge numbers of displaced Germans, especially towards the end of the war in 1944 to 1945. Now, even at the beginning of the war, there had been some Germans who had actually fled from other areas further into Germany. But obviously, the bombings from May 1942 then started to lead to larger numbers of refugees. Not only that, but also as the Soviet army advanced through eastern Germany in 1944 and 1945, lots of the population decided to run away from them and fled westwards in order to avoid the brutality of the Soviet soldiers. Soviet soldiers were incredibly harsh and carried out some very brutal treatment of German people. There were a lot of rapes that went on, but there was also a lot of looting, a lot of beatings. I think really in response to the 20 million Soviet soldiers that lost their lives in World War II. No excuse for it, but there was this real culture of hatred that developed amongst some of the soldiers who had been through a lot in the Second World War. As a result of this, we had 11 million ethnic Germans who were either refugees or had been expelled from countries. And obviously, that's going to cause huge problems after the war. You know, even people that want to go back home after the war, some of their homes have been destroyed or they've been taken over by other people. It caused a real crisis that they had to try and solve after 1945. The last area that we need to know about for our spider diagram is employment and the labour shortages. Now, this is because in total, 13.7 million German men served in the army during the Second World War. And as a result, it created a huge labour shortages on the home front. Now, they didn't want to use women to replace those men, because remember, their whole ideology was about women being focused on being wives and mothers and about focusing on children, church and cooking, the three Ks, as they called it. So they had this real tension where they needed a lot of jobs to fill, but they didn't have the people to do it. Now, the person that was in charge of making sure that the German economy was producing enough goods to fight in the Second World War was somebody called Albert Speer, who you can see here at the bottom. So he was the armaments minister, and it was his job to try and prepare their economy for war and make sure they were building enough tanks and weapons to be able to fight and win. Now, in order to try and solve that problem of the limited workers that they had in Germany, they started to use women from 1943 and asked all women between the ages of 17 and 45 to register for work and work unless, for instance, they were pregnant. They also, absolutely horrendously, used so many million foreign workers as slaves, essentially, and slave labour in these terrible factories where they had to work incredibly long hours, brutal conditions, for basically not much money or not much food, not much resources. So these conditions were so awful that so many people actually died because of the brutal treatment in these places, and they just replaced them with new people from the conquered territories. So in terms of employment, they had labour shortages and issues with it, but they filled it with using foreign workers and also changing their ideology with regards to women and getting women to work in these factories as well. So this is the last area on your spider diagram. Pause it here to be able to make your notes. Okay, so you've now done the notes for the lesson, and that was actually the last set of notes for the Nazi Germany course. You've now got everything you need for future exams. If you happen to have finished more than 5 minutes before the end, please still message your teacher on Teams and they'll give you something to do. But remember, everybody needs to be back for the last 5 minutes of the lesson to review your learning and for you to answer a question that your teacher will talk to you about then. Okay, thank you for listening.